This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Well, Kathleen Marden is back with us on Dreamland. She's been a frequent guest over the years, or fairly frequent, about every 2 or 3 years. I guess your last visit was in 2019. And Kathleen is one of the preeminent ufologists of our time. There's a little question of that. She's been researching this material since 1990, and she has worked with Stanton Friedman. They wrote a number of books together. She has been involved in MUFON's abduction research program. She has a BA in social work. Her interest in UFOs began in an interesting way. In 1961, two people had one of the all-time classic UFO experiences, and in fact, the first abduction experience that was ever widely reported, Betty and Barney Hill. Kathleen is their niece. She's the niece of Betty and Barney. And she spent 15 years analyzing their abduction and seeking to understand what has happened to them. Subsequently, she has worked on with probably at this point over 5,000 experiencers. She has 5 books published, captured: The Betty and Barney Hill UFO Experience, Science Was Wrong, Fact, Fiction, and Flying Saucers, The Alien Abduction Files with Denise Stoner. We interviewed them both on Dreamland. Extraterrestrial Contact, What to Do When You've Been Abducted. I interviewed Kathleen about that on Dreamland, and it's also mentioned extensively in my book, A New World, because it's an extremely important contribution to the field. She's also a contributor to the Edgar Mitchell Free Foundation, their publication Beyond UFOs, The Science of Consciousness and Contact with Non-Human Intelligence. And you can reach her at KathleenMarden.com. Have I left anything out? Kathleen, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Whitley. I've been busy. So, yes, things have been left out, but that was long enough.
You surely have. You've been very busy, and that's great. Now, Kathleen, before we get into what you're doing right now, I'd like to go back to, and if I've just recently listened to the interviews we've done before, and we haven't really talked much about Betty and Barney and what happened there that drew your interest. Here they were, your aunt and uncle. It's the early 60s. You're younger than you are now, as we all were. What drew your interest to them, and what had happened to them?
Well, Whitley, I was 13 years old and had just arrived home from school on September 20th, 1961, and found my mother on the telephone with Betty. And she and Barney had taken a short vacation to Niagara Falls, had returned home via Canada, spent a day in Canada, and then had a close encounter on their way home. And Betty was concerned that the craft had come so close to them that they might have been contaminated. She and Barney had taken long showers when they arrived home. My mother was going to speak to a neighbor of ours who was a physicist to ask for his recommendations. Within 2 days, I was with my family at Betty's and Barney's home. I saw some of the evidence myself, and being very close family members, I saw the unfolding of everything that occurred. Betty's intense curiosity to find answers about what had happened to them, Barney's denial, Barney's emotional attempt to just forget about it. No good could come of it. He had to forget about this as fast as possible, but he couldn't forget about it. And I saw the change that took place in Barney from being the happy-go-lucky uncle who spent a lot of time with his nieces and nephews every weekend, sometimes more than once a week. And then there was the Barney who was very troubled, who developed bleeding ulcers, who had to take a 3-month leave of absence from work because he was hospitalized with these bleeding ulcers and high blood pressure that would not recede with traditional medical treatment. And this was troubling to me as a youngster because I loved Betty and Barney. And I was extraordinarily curious as well. I was like Betty in that I wanted to know what had happened. What about those shiny spots on the trunk of their vehicle that hadn't been there the day before, that were in the location where they heard those buzzing sounds as they were traveling home the previous evening? What caused that? What caused the tingling sensations to pass through their bodies, their car to vibrate, for them to forget, to have a period of time, missing time, with vague memories about what had occurred during this period? So all sorts of questions. I had the opportunity to meet and observe many of the leading UFO investigators in that time frame, and was impressed by them, by their credentials, and always felt that I wanted to be like them.
You mentioned evidence, and the you touched on the shiny spots on the car. Can you describe the evidence that you were aware of right then, right, literally right at first?
Yes, I was aware that their watches had stopped running, that they never ran again, in fact, that the leather strap on Barney's binoculars that he had been wearing around his neck when he walked into the field and observed these non-humans staring down at him, who he felt greatly threatened by. He felt that he was going to be captured. He pulled the binoculars away from his eyes so strenuously that he broke that leather strap. The fear that Barney exhibited, the fact that his best dress shoes were so deeply scraped that he had to purchase new shoes, that Betty's dress was torn, that there were many questions without answers.
And Betty had a very different reaction to it than Barney.
Yes.
Barney had a rough reaction, but not Betty. Betty had, tell us about Betty's reaction and her personality.
Betty was highly intelligent and a powerful woman. She was feisty, and she wanted to learn as much as she could about what had happened. She went to the Portsmouth Public Library and took out the first book that she had ever read on the topic. There was an address inside the book for the National Investigations Committee on Aerial Phenomena. So a few days later, she sat down with Barney and wrote a letter to NICAP. And that brought Walter Webb, astronomer and investigator, to their home. She talked to people in the Air Force about this. The upstairs neighbors, her tenants, were in the man was in the Air Force, stationed at Pease Air Force Base. She wanted to know more. What had Pease seen that craft? And yes, it was recorded on radar or a craft, was recorded on radar by Pease Air Force Base at 2:14 a.m., at about the time that we later found out they were released. That could explain what happened to them. Betty had memories of finding themselves on a dirt road with tall trees all around, of encountering a roadblock, of observing a fiery orb that seemed to be sitting on the ground, trying to dismiss it as the setting moon, but knowing that it couldn't possibly have been that. And in the fall of 1961, the late fall, and then into the spring, she and Barney would make trips, weekend trips, to the White Mountains to try to find that road that they found themselves on, where they encountered that roadblock. So Betty had no conscious recall of observing these entities. Barney did. I mean, Betty only remembered a roadblock. She didn't remember what they looked like. Barney had conscious recall of observing the entities when he was standing in that field, looking up at that craft that was hovering only 100 feet overhead, of seeing little lights slide out from two parts of the craft and something start to drop down out of the bottom of the craft that frightened him so badly. Betty was curious. She would talk to anyone. She talked to UFO investigators. She talked to military people. She talked to scientists, anyone who might have some information that could help her to understand what had occurred that night.
Now, Barney, what can you tell us what Barney saw when he looked up at the craft and saw the entities looking down at him? What did he see?
Well, I have the original records, and what he saw were figures dressed in black shiny uniforms looking down at him. And then suddenly, all but one turned and walked to what appeared to be a panel. When this occurred, he could now see them from the tops of their heads to their knees. And their arms went up. And when this occurred, little red lights started to slide out from the craft on fin-like structures. And this is when something started to drop down as well. He was looking at the one who remained at the window and was greatly frightened by him. Barney thought that he was about to be captured like a bug in a net. And that's a quote. He, in his earliest report to Walter Webb, stated that these entities were somehow not human. They were of a superior type.
I wonder why he said superior.
They were absolutely technologically superior.
Yes.
You know, so I don't know. I can't read Barney's mind. That's a good question.
Yeah, because he seemed to sense, Barney seemed to have more of a sense of the sort of the gestalt or the feeling of the situation than Betty did.
Yes.
Betty first had no memories, no direct memories, so she wasn't aware of the sense that Barney had that they were about to be captured.
Correct.
Like a bug. I mean, it's a... Do you suppose Barney had some previous awareness of this buried in him somewhere?
There's a possibility. He and Betty were hypnotized separately by Dr. Benjamin Simon, beginning in January of 1964. And the questions actually started in February of that month. But he took Betty and Barney separately, and he reinstated amnesia at the end of each session. And he was talking to Barney. It was more like hypnoanalysis for Barney, because Dr. Simon was a psychoanalyst. And he would always ask Barney to compare his emotional state to some time in the past. And when Barney was looking up at this craft as it was hovering overhead, it reminded him of a time when he was a child in a field on the farm in Virginia. And he talked about a little bunny, and the bunny thought that he was protected, but that Barney was able to take his hat and put it down and catch that little bunny. And Barney said to Dr. Simon, "I'm that bunny." So had Barney previously had contact? I don't know. There's a possibility of it, but I do believe that Betty probably did.
So why do you believe that of Betty? Well, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Free Dreamlanders, I've got to admit, it's time for you to look at some commercials or listen to them. We'll be right back. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Kathleen Marden. Her website, kathleen-marden.com. You can find all of her books there, and some of them are also available on the unknowncountry.com store. But if you want an autographed copy of her books, the place to go is kathleenmarden.com. You can also find out there what she's up to, which is always a lot. Tell us, Kathleen, before we go on, where you're going to be speaking next.
I have a conference coming up in Italy, but it's going to be a virtual conference like most of the conferences this year.
Yes. Yeah, I've missed all of the non-virtual conferences for one reason or another. I know you made it to Roswell.
Yes, and to Michigan, too.
Yeah, and I missed both of them. I all I can say is this, folks, if you want to go somewhere and you have a specific schedule and something to do, I would avoid American Airlines and Southwest Airlines because they do not work properly anymore. Now let's get back to Betty. And your thought that Betty may have had abduction experiences before.
Yes. I do believe that there's a possibility that this occurred. The reason I believe that is because she didn't have the level of fear that Barney had initially. Yet when she realized under hypnosis that they were the entities that Barney had seen when he was in the field looking up at them, he told her that. She became terrified. She tried to escape and run away from them, but she failed. When she was being taken to craft, she then again fought for her life and tore her dress in the process before they took control of her. But she lost her fear. She spoke to the one that she called the leader, that I think of as the escort who makes experiencers feel comfortable and in a familiar environment. She said to him, "I know you're not from around here. Where's your home port?" And he showed her a star map that became very important evidence. Yes. In her case, when Dr. Simon asked her to draw it from memory, if she could remember it accurately, and it didn't trouble her too much. So that was just another piece of evidence. But as she was leaving the craft, after she had fought for that, what she called a book that was sort of like a tablet with alien script or symbols embedded in it. She was being escorted out. They wouldn't give her the book. She was being escorted out, and she was talking to the leader, and he seemed apologetic. This is telepathic communication. Apologetic for frightening her so badly, even though they did tell Betty and Barney they wouldn't be harmed. They only had to do a few simple tests. And Betty finally said to him, "Well, do you think you could come back? If you can come back again, then I can find people who know a lot more about this than I do. I'm just a common person," she said. And he said to her, "It's not my decision to make. Maybe I can come back." And Betty said to him, "Well, how would you find me? Out of all of the people on this planet, how would you find me?" And he said, "We can always find those we're looking for." It made me think that they were probably looking for Betty that night.
Do you think that this is something that has been running in your family?
I do think that. And the reason that I think that is Dr. James Harder came to my family in the 1970s. And he hypnotized several members of my family. My mother had a close encounter with a craft way back in 1957 when she was making her weekly grocery shopping trip. Another aunt was with her, and there was a very large, what we think of as a mothership, cigar-shaped, hovering over a field. And there were smaller craft flying into it or out of it, around it. She stopped the car at a nearby house. She knew the people who lived there, and they saw this craft as well. So it became a multiple witness sighting. Then there was another time that I remember. I was a little older in my teenage years, and she was grocery shopping on a Friday night again. And this time she simply did not arrive home at the appointed time. She was very consistent in the time that she would arrive home. And we were distressed over this, what had happened to my mother. My father was talking about calling the police. And finally, my mother arrived. And when she did, she didn't realize that she was late. The frozen food had thawed, the ice cream was soup, and there was no explanation for what had occurred. So Jim Harder was interested in this. In addition to this, in 1966, Betty was working with a team of scientists. They would give her a script that she was to read and attempt to contact through telepathic communication these extraterrestrials. And she was outside doing this night after night. And one of the things that she was supposed to tell them was that they should land on my grandparents' farm in Kingston, New Hampshire. I grew up across the street from my grandparents' farm. One did come in and land. It was observed by my grandmother and by a commercial pilot who was returning home from work. And I had memories of finding myself on a craft. I didn't talk about it at first. It was a trust issue with my mother because she was there. And I thought that she had coordinated some kind of secret surgery on me and had brought a medical team in, which doesn't make sense at all to me as an adult.
Right.
But that was the only explanation I had at that time. But I couldn't remember the faces on those doctors who were standing around me. And finally, I had an abreaction, a huge release of emotion, and I recalled what they looked like. And they were the type of grays that abducted my aunt and uncle. And then periodically, I had contact.
And now here you are.
Yes, here I am.
All of these years later, just like the rest of us who are vocal about this, not many of us who are out in public have had just a single experience, unless it was a very extraordinary and intensely memorable one, like the one that happened, say, to Mark Sims, who had his, I don't know if you know Mark's story, but my listeners do. He's been on the show, and he's become a good friend, but he had a single overwhelmingly powerful experience of meeting an entity that he believes is called Tejabar. And it turned out it's just an extraordinary story, folks. So if you're a subscriber, go and listen to the Mark Sims show. You'll find it fascinating. In any case, that's a rarity. Mm-hmm. Most of us have had lifelong contact and still do. I mean, I'm still involved with them. I'm not being abducted anymore, I don't think. But my last missing time experience was a couple of months ago. When speaking of Mark Sims, he and Danny Sheehan were coming over, and we were going to spend the afternoon together and have dinner. And I proceeded to have a missing time experience, which was easily identified. There's no question at all. It was a 23-minute to 22-minute missing time experience right before they came. Mm-hmm. And what in the world was it about? And so is the experience still active in your life at this point?
It is active, but it has changed. Back in 2016, I began a series of experiments with a man who had been communicating with a group of extraterrestrials dating back to when he was an 8-year-old boy. And this was just a sort of an observational experiment. We didn't know if he was delusional, if he was a hoaxer, what was going on. And we met once a month for 2 years. And each of us in the group of researchers were invited to ask questions, which we did, and we received answers. We met the Council of Eight, the individuals in the council, through Kevin, who is a medium, who sort of channeled the information. There were two ninth dimensionals, and those ninth dimensionals had an incredible amount of energy, just filling up the room with this very strong tingling sensation in our bodies. They increase the temperature in that portion of the room by about 7 degrees when they were there. There were also other members of the Council of Eight that we were introduced to. For the most part, we couldn't see them. We did see what appeared to be feathers on one, but there were different varieties of ETs. There were tall human types. There was an average gray and a tall gray. There was an avian. There was a tall white. And there was an insectoid.
And they were, you know, I don't have any sense personally of any organization or any large groups like that. I know Kevin also. He's been on the show. I believe you're speaking of Kevin.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Right. He's been on this show as well. And he was present. He was actually driving the car around in the Black Hills in the, on the Lakota Sioux Reservation on the, in the summer of 2019, when I had the experience of seeing into another world, apparently a parallel universe. And I'm going to bring that up in a little while, because there's a fascinating story in your latest book about it that I mention in A New World, and I want to talk about it a little further later. In any case, I have no sense of these organizations at all. It's a very personal experience for me, my contact experience. I use my implant to do research on my books. And at 3 o'clock in the morning, I usually have an exchange about what I'm working on with somebody. I don't even know who it is. I sometimes think it's my wife, but I'm never sure.
Yes.
I've never been sure.
Well, I've never been sure that they were extraterrestrials. I've never been sure that they were extraterrestrials. But I do know that the extraterrestrials that I had contact with during my lifetime are no longer taking me. And they haven't taken me since this group said that they would protect me. And I look at them.
You're saying that being taken is something hostile or something we don't want.
Well, I was terrified for years and years and could not resolve that terror. I finally developed a technique that I used to overcome that feeling of fear, that fight or flight response, by instantly hypnotizing myself when they came into my environment and projecting love toward them. That changed everything.
That's interesting, because my book, Jesus, A New Vision, which is about embracing the good, changed everything for me very profoundly. Mm-hmm. I don't have those awful, that awful sense of doom, I would say, that of being something awful being done to me that I used to live with, and I lived with for a long time. But some of the scars that remain from my early experiences will never leave me. Mm-hmm. And I had semen taken from my body, and that is, I'll never forget it. And I'll never stop wondering what happened to that part of me, because that was part of me given to me by God, and it was taken. Mm-hmm. You cannot rape a man more profoundly than that. Mm-hmm. You can't do it. And I know many women have had similar and awful things happen to them with regard to their eggs. And I've seen babies. They've seen babies. What is your reaction to this? How do you understand this aspect of it?
The way I've come to understand it is that these grays are what I think of as the collectors. When we began to explode nuclear weapons, they tore into the fabric of time and space and across dimensions and caused harm in other dimensions, and these entities came through. They were seen. Their craft was seen every time there was the detonation of a nuclear weapon. In fact, the early scientists wondered if they were somehow some kind of fallout as a result of what had occurred. And so they are very concerned that our technological progress is out of balance with our spiritual growth. And when this occurs, there can be a massive loss of life, a huge holocaust that destroys life on the planet. And they say that they planted our seed here, that they have come back from time to time to assist in our development. And this time they are alarmed. They haven't left. They have been collecting DNA of flora and fauna and even humans for many, many years in case it happens. But Kevin's counsel said that we have destroyed ourselves before, and they won't let us do it this time. They will intervene. They will shoot down our missiles if they can. They're also very concerned about population that have not been good stewards to the environment, who have exploited the planet to our own detriment. And they, I believe, are attempting to upgrade the human genome to produce a more survivable, more resilient, and more highly spiritually involved human.
Spiritually competent, I would say.
Yeah.
Well, Free Dreamlanders, speaking of competence, it's time for you to take a little break, enjoy these commercials, and we'll be right back with Kathleen Marden.
Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing, he was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us. And his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, "I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla." And I said, "Well, why not?" And he says, "Well, you can't wear that color." So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, "Well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring." And I said, "Well, what would happen?" And they said, "Well, people disappear."
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the UnknownCountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on UnknownCountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to UnknownCountry.com right now and get started. We're talking to Kathleen Marden. Her website, Kathleen-Marden, M-A-R-D-E-N.com. You can find her many books there. And if you want an autographed copy, that's where to get it. Kathleen, can people get directly in touch with you?
They can. They can go to my website at Kathleen-Marden.com. And all of my books are available to be purchased through PayPal, and I will autograph all of them.
Great. Well, that would be worth doing, folks. And so, because Kathleen is a truly extraordinary and unique individual in this field, as you can see, she came to it. She was really brought to it, in a sense, by the visitors themselves, and ended up in this extraordinary situation of having not only a lifetime of experience with them and the niece of the man and woman who had one of the most famous experiences of all time, and she is highly knowledgeable and skilled and capable as a researcher. And isn't it extraordinary, Kathleen, how strange the conclusions you draw are in terms of this research, because it's obvious that something is being done that involves our bodies.
Yes.
And, I've thought that maybe they might be making a kind of genetic record of us on the theory that we might go extinct. Could that be a possibility? Because not only is our nuclear weapons and nuclear catastrophes definitely of interest to them, so is environmental stuff. I've gotten a lot of that. I've written two books as a result of that, in fact, Nature's End and Superstorm, as a result of their warnings. So I have to wonder, is this a hostile presence, or are they trying to preserve something? I just can't quite get my head around where they are. And I thought that you might have a better idea of that.
In terms of their presence, I know that a small group is hostile, but for the most part, these non-humans are not hostile. They're collectors, they're caretakers of the planet, in a sense. On the studies that I participated in as a researcher, the first being the Edgar Mitchell Free Foundation's experience or study, 83%, I believe it was, stated that they would not end their contact experiences if they had the opportunity to do so. We asked the same question of the 516 people who participated in our MUFON experience or research team study. And 71% of the experiencers, 75% of the abductee group said that they would not end their experiences. So there's something that draws them to these non-humans. A sense that they want to learn more. I can tell you from my own personal experience, they projected a feeling of love toward me that was greater than any love I have ever experienced on this planet. And they telepathically told me that we are family, that there is no reason to be fearful. They told me that they had to extract these tissues from my body because they were checking me for toxicity. And as I think about that, Whitley, I grew up just downhill from a waste dump, a chemical waste dump that polluted the rivers, the streams, the wells, and the lake. It became a Superfund site, and only 20 miles from my childhood home and where Betty and Barney lived were a nuclear Air Force base and a nuclear submarine base. So,
how interesting. That's absolute. I did not know that before. And yet I happen to know that there are numerous people in the nuclear submarine fleet who have had very extensive encounters. In fact, we had a show on Dreamland with two of them, a man and woman who preferred to remain anonymous, who had an encounter that lasted days. And he was a communications officer on a nuclear submarine. And so that group of people is a special group. A lot of military people are involved in this in different ways. Mm-hmm. And not only that, when pilots are ordered to make aggressive maneuvers toward these things, these objects, as likely as not, the visitors show up a little while later in their children's bedrooms. There's a definite correlation there.
There is, and I found that in my work as well, Whitley. The children and the enlisted people on nuclear bases, and also the children of nuclear engineers, scientists working on nuclear programs for the U.S. government.
Yes, that too. And special forces officers and a lot of different military people are involved. Now, this gets me to a very large question that I've been wanting to ask more often of different experts who have come on the show. This seems to me to be very much farther advanced in the United States than it is anywhere else in the world. I mean, the whole meshing of contact that's going on. Am I wrong about that? And if I'm not, if you feel it's the case, can you discuss why you think it may be the case?
Well, Whitley, I think that in the United States, we have physicists who are working on this, such as Rudy Shield and Claude Swanson, who have moved us ahead in our understanding that this is beyond the nuts and bolts, that it is much more, that it involves consciousness. And we have been open with our studies of consciousness. So I think that we have a population in the United States that has greater knowledge of all of this. And some of the investigators are open to this. The investigators on MUFON's experience or resource team, that's what it's called now, and are far more open-minded. They realize that there are orbs, that intelligent orbs in people's homes involved in all of this, yes. That there is communication with what appears to be maybe a non-human to a human. The human's visual range cannot see that individual, but they can certainly feel the tingling sensation and receive the telepathic messages. When I have written or done programs in Europe, I found that the investigators are years behind us in their investigations. They're still in the nuts and bolts. They're still wondering if alien abduction is even real, if what the evidence is for it. So I guess that Italy is more open-minded, but certainly other parts of Europe are not. In Australia, I'm finding that people are more open-minded as well.
Yes. Australia is another country that has had a lot of this.
Yes.
Yeah, I think it's second only to the United States in that respect. Mm-hmm. And they've got a big installation there at Pine Gap, which has a lot to do with this stuff, I'm pretty sure. Mm-hmm. Now, when we... when we look at this and we look at the research that's been done, there are researchers who are very sure that this is something really, really evil and really dangerous. And they have, I don't know if it's a self-selected sample or not. I'm on the fence because I've had all of the worst experiences that Bud Hopkins and Dave Jacobs talk about happened to me and my wife, every single one of them. And they were not easy. They're terrible experiences. They're right about that. But it's not so much happening anymore. The abductions, I think, are they over, would you say? I think Ray Hernandez of Free thinks they pretty much are.
The ERT MUFON has discussed that. They think that the breeding program is probably over, and not as many people are being taken to craft. I've spoken to individuals who now will just see a portion of their home open up and these entities just step into the human environment.
I've seen that myself. I woke up one night at my country place and the roof was gone. We had a cathedral ceiling in the bedroom and there was nothing there. But the thing that was so remarkable is above it, you did not see stars. You saw just darkness, and it was awesome, whatever that darkness was. And then I could see these entities peering down at me around the edges of this open roof. And the next thing I knew, I ended up having something like a life review that must be like what happens after you're dead, I guess. And those are dramatic experiences, and a lot of us have them. You've had them too, I'm sure.
I have. And I've been wondering what this is all about. Why am I having these life reviews over again?
Me too. And, you know, when we're coming to the end of the free part of Dreamland, and when we go on, we're going to be talking more about these experiences and more also, I want to get back to the star map, and I want to discuss possible ways of moving between the stars, because after all, even if you're moving at 99% of the speed of light, you're crawling because the distances between the stars are so enormous. But we want to get into that. So, Free Dreamlanders, I would like to thank you for being with us as always. And each week, some of you, three or four of you, usually not many more than that, will subscribe to the show. I would hope that this week it's more. And if you've been thinking about doing it, you can listen to the previous Kathleen Marden shows. You can listen to our wonderful show with Kevin Briggs. There is so much on Dreamland, on Unknown Country, that you can value. Now, to get more deeply into Kathleen and her work, which I advise strongly, go to Kathleen Marden. That's Kathleen-Marden, MARDEN.com, and take it from there. Her books are truly remarkable works. I think I've actually read them all. And we have just touched on some of the things. Extraterrestrial Contact is the last one we interviewed Kathleen about on this show in 2019, a remarkable book. Prior to that, we talked with her about Captured. We talked with her about Fact, Fiction, and Flying Saucers. We had a long interview with her and Denise Stoker about the alien abduction files. There is so much here. Thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland, and subscribers. We're just going to keep right on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland, Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.